to be maybe the motivation for it, or in my mind, I'm sure there was a lot more to it than that. But it does go through in much detail the science behind climate change, and it does talk.
Solar panels, these are mirrors. And what they do is they reflect all of the light onto this top of this tower, which generates heat and burns, it starts to boil water to turn a turbine. So this is near Seville, the plant, a solar 10 plant, again in Spain, because they get a lot of sun. Wind energy, of course, off the shores of Copenhagen, you can see wind farms like this. There's geo-exchange, which is kind of essentially a heat pump, where you access the consistent temperatures below the ground, and you can heat your house in the winter and cool your house in the summer without needing to burn fossil fuels. Geothermal, as opposed to geo-exchange, is really more properly when we're accessing the heat deep in our planet, so you need power stations for that. There's other innovative things you can do. You can turn, I mean, if you've got a big metropolis like Chicago or Toronto, you can make every surface on the top green, so that from above it would still look like a big untouched landscape. So that's one thing that can be considered. Some places are innovative. This is just in Manhattan, but they call this the science barge. They've got greenhouses, they've got solar panels. Another thing that's been explored, carbon capture and storage, trying to remove carbon dioxide before it's ever released into the atmosphere, buried in the ground. Nuclear energy, a little bit controversial, because of course it's got its own environmental concerns. You have to mine for the uranium, you have to dispose of nuclear waste, but practically speaking, it's the only thing we can do today that can provide the energy needs of the planet and not produce the emissions. So it may at least be a part of the solution transition. I was in Hawaii. If anybody follows my blog, they'll know all this stuff, but I was in Hawaii in March break with my family. We went to the Polynesian Cultural Center. I was very interested in how Hawaii was dealing with green things. Read my blog if you want to know what they're doing. But as we're walking there, you know, right next to the handicap parking spots were these parking spots, reserved for electric vehicles only. You could charge your car while you were there. I thought that was amazing. Just last week, I only got home Sunday, I was in Barcelona, Spain, and outside my window, I saw this. This is the largest solar array in all of Europe. Barcelona is extremely green. I was there for a medical meeting, and these were the boxes they had. You know, I always thought RVH was doing a good job, because we have four boxes up front for waste and certain different disposables. They've got six at every meeting they go to for, they've got for paper, for plastic, for metal, for compostable, for garbage. They're very green. That city is very forward-thinking. And in fact, at the meeting, when my materials are there at my desk for the actual stuff we were going to discuss, and they always provide a pen so you can write in case you don't bring your own. The pens are biodegradable. I brought it in case anybody wants to see it. You take the refill out, you can throw this in your compost, and it's done. So I was very impressed with what they did there. These are the kinds of innovations people need to think about if we're going to come up with solutions. Now, I like, if anybody ever follows anything I do on Facebook, they'll see that every morning at about 5:30, I spit out some little quote, because I just like, it's a way to wake me up more than anything. But I find a lot of good Chinese proverbs out there. So I'm going to give you this one, which is cautionary, as you'll see. Be careful of your thoughts, for your thoughts become your words. Be careful of your words, because your words become your actions. Be careful of your actions become your habits. Be careful of your habits, for your habits become your character. And be careful of your character, for your character becomes your destiny. Now, as you can see, the way that's phrased, that's quite cautionary in how its approach is. But if you take the key words out of there, thoughts, words, actions, habits, character, destiny, this can be positive. You can put a positive spin on this. And you could ask yourself, if you are a believer in doing what's right to help the planet in this issue, maybe ask yourself at what stage are you at on this spectrum? I talk to a lot of people who believe strongly in this issue, but they are concerned about, can we really do this? You know, in fact, on the interview I just did with LA Talk Radio before I came here, which is why I was late, they asked that same thing, and I point out, you know, it's kind of like saying, should I vote in an election? I'm just one vote. What difference do I make? And I guess, obviously, if everybody has that attitude, then we're all in the dumpster about it. Every little bit of difference helps. And I like this quote from Margaret Mead, never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever has. So everybody in this room is making a difference, and don't you forget it, because it all counts. This is the last slide I've got to show. Does anybody know what it is? I told you I started with an astronomical photo, and now I've got another one.
Milky Way?
Pale blue dot. This is Earth, from 6 billion kilometers away. Voyager 1 took this photo after it pictured all of the the planets, the gas giants on the outside. And I just think it's impressive to realize that, you know, I started with the picture that's on the cover of my book, but this little dot, just barely a pixel, is everything we're trying to preserve here. We've got nowhere else we can go, so we got to do our best to try and take care of this place. So I appreciate all of the attention you guys have given me and invited me to come and speak to you. I hope it was useful, and I hope you don't feel you wasted your time by having me come here. And I think we have a few minutes for questions before you guys do your wrap-up discussion. So thanks a lot, everyone. And I'll see people who've had part of their lung lopped out for cancer, and they've needed bypass surgery for their coronary artery disease, and they still smoke. And so I thought, if all of these people are smoking still, despite the fact that they've got the problem, how do we hope to have a planet adopt an attitude that's not necessarily for them today, but for generations to come in the future? And it's very tough. And so through the chapter, I explore things like the utility quotient that people like Jeremy Bentham and John Stuart Mill explored. It's sort of, we're getting into kind of philosophy about things. But I think what it boils down to, if I was going to summarize in a nutshell, is people are resistant to change because they do what makes them happy. And they generally do what makes them happy in a short term rather than a long term. So if I could tell a smoker, I know in 10 years you will die from cancer if you keep smoking, they're still less likely to quit because right now they'd rather not struggle with the stress of quitting smoking. And so the short term gain is they've still got their stress relief, they've still got their habit or their addiction. And I'm not picking on smokers, well, I guess I do because as a cardiologist, it's my bread and butter. But I'm using it as an example. But they continue to stick with these bad choices because in the short term, it benefits them. The long term is harder for them to see, even if it's their own life. And as I said, when you're talking about things that are lives, like many generations to come that are going to face problems, it's even harder. In that chapter, I talked about things like, it is hard to put a face on this issue. Some commercials use like polar bears. That's one a lot of people can relate to. If you're an animal lover, or if you're a believer in global warming, that speaks to you and you care about it. But you can't put, like, I can throw a sick person up there on a slide to say, this is a person with cancer, let's give to cancer care. And that speaks to people. Or I can show an animal in a shelter and say, let's give to the Humane Society. But I can't show you somebody in hundreds of years who's struggling with global warming because we don't have those pictures. And it's harder for people to relate to that. It's interesting, the philosophy. There were studies done that showed, in a book that I put in my suggested reading at the end of that chapter, they've done studies to show people care more about one individual suffering than a whole group. And that's why the animal shelter commercials have one dog. And the sick person is one person. You don't show 100 different. We don't talk, as Stalin said, you know, one death is a tragedy, but a million deaths is a statistic. So it's really hard to motivate these people. Eric, I see your hand up there.
So obviously you care about this issue a lot, because you wrote a book about it, which is more than most people have done. So I assume it's...
Yeah, with all my free time.
Exactly.
That's what I did.
So I assume it's pretty high on your priority list.
Yeah.
And you talk about the little things sort of adding up. Now, everyone in this room could adopt a zero-footprint lifestyle, but that would be completely negated by the next subdivision that goes up in the south end. But if everyone in Barrie adopted a zero-footprint lifestyle, or everyone who's bought and read your book went to a zero-footprint lifestyle, that would still be negated vastly by huge increases from expanding tar sands so we can pump more bitumen to China through new pipelines or into the States. And so it becomes, isn't there a certain futility in hoping for basically personal action when there are other persons doing an equal and opposite and more than equal action in the other direction? And so isn't there a role in there, a critical role for municipal, our provincial, and our federal governments to also try to balance these better so that at least we're not increasing the emissions before we can even try to reduce them?
Absolutely. I mean, I could not agree more with that statement. I think that everybody has to do what they can. My chapter 6 was solutions we can do as individuals and families. My chapter 7 is what governments and societies and nations can do. And I tackle the hurdles of what has not really been accomplished with Kyoto and Copenhagen. But we have to do what we can. And I'm not prepared to ever give in. There's a part of me that worries we're destined for real disaster in generations to come. And to be honest, if I had to predict, I'm going to say we're going to face problems. There's no doubt. So at this point, I'm not trying to prevent them. I'm trying to minimize them because I really think the damage is already well in place. But I kind of think of it like it's a growing movement. And, you know, it's not all that long ago you never saw recycling bins anywhere. And we've got those. It's not that long ago that I was in City Hall arguing for smoking bans, and it got turned down. And now it's hard to smoke in public in Barrie. So changes happen. And it's kind of like a disease that's running dormant or slowly spreading. And I think as people care about this and spread the word and make movements and make efforts to make changes, it starts to happen and eventually reaches a point where it will take off. And of course, it will take off if the planet is in crisis. You know, when Haiti has its problems, when Bangladesh has its problems, when Japan has its problems, the world steps in and nobody cares what party you're a member of or what nation you are or what color you are, everybody helps. So they'll help when it's a crisis. I'm just hoping they'll help before it's a crisis. And I've talked to all three levels of government. In fact, not that long ago, I had Peter Kent in my home talking about this issue because we had a little event where I wanted to have his ear. And so I made the event happen so I could talk to him about it. And it's, you know, I understand what our federal government is doing and why it's doing it. I just disagree with it on these issues. And I'd rather have his ear so he can hear what I have to say and give him a copy of my book so he realizes, look, I'm not some bizarre extremist. I'm a rational person who's trying to put forth an argument. And I think we've got to do what we can do on every level. I don't think we should ever stop. If we never stop, we'll make it happen eventually, probably beyond our lifetimes, but it'll happen. But you think about other, you know, in the 19th century in the South, slavery still existed. And they worked hard, and they're still working hard on civil rights. That battle's not over, but lots of headway has happened. South of the border, they've got an African-American president, for crying out loud. So change happens. It's, it just takes time, but if we ever give up, we're committing to defeat.
So there's a line of reasoning in your book that you described, and in reading it, it wasn't clear to me whether you accepted that line of reasoning or not. So I wanted to ask you about that. And it's about things like international treaties, like Kyoto or other ones like that. And something that's incredibly unusual, almost unheard of, is for all countries to all agree at the same time to something. So generally, you start with some countries agreeing and you try and get more to agree. But in the case of Kyoto, countries like the United States under George Bush and now Canada under Stephen Harper have argued that because everybody isn't on board, it doesn't matter, so we'll not sign on. And that's an argument.
Yeah,
it's not a fact, it's an opinion. Do you accept that line of reasoning that says, well, until everyone's on board, our action is futile, so we won't commit to doing anything until everyone else commits? And do you see that as having a...
I think it's an awful line of reasoning. If I was prime minister, which I never will be, because I don't want to be a politician. I give lots of props to people who aspire to that, because I couldn't do it. But
that's what Ron Paul said.
Pardon?
That's what Ron Paul said.
Yeah. Well, he's out of
and he was a doctor, too.
He still is. If I was prime minister, and I'm a strong believer in this, I would do the right thing, which means I don't care about getting elected the next time. I'm going to do what I can to do the right thing. And I think that's what more politicians today need to do. They need to worry a little bit less about the next election, a little bit more about what's right for the planet. When you look at the best politicians in the world through history, and of course you can argue whether Winston Churchill was great or not, but when you look at them, the ones that I admire who did accomplish things, they generally did what they thought was right and not necessarily what was right for the next election. And sometimes that came back to bite them in the butt and they did lose the next election, but still their stamp is there on history. So if I was prime minister, I would do everything to shut down what's happening in Alberta because I think it's awful. And I would say, let's put our investments not into supplying oil through bitumen to the rest of the planet. Let's invest in being the greenest nation possible so that we can generate all of the renewable resources and we can show it can be done. I was very impressed in Barcelona, and that's why I like to post about these in my blog. I like to say, look what this community is doing, look what that community is doing, because we can do it too if we really put our minds to it. But I think that's what's most important, is doing what's right for the long term and less what's right so we get elected the next time. I understand the philosophy that if we don't get elected, we can't carry on our long-term plans. But I think somebody's just got to stand up and be a leader. And that's what I hope. You guys have to talk about other things. So. on forever, but thanks, Eric.
I just wanted to, we did sort of last minute thank you to Dr. Dibble for coming. We've just communicated by email. We really didn't have a chance to chat this out, but I'm really, really impressed with the content and the thought and all the work you put into this. Mike and I were at a presentation you did for the Diabetic Association, and we were in the audience, and they prefaced the discussion saying, oh yeah, Dr. Dibble's written a book on climate change, and we looked at each other like,
what?
So we had to talk, we never got around it. Anyway, this is a little thank you from us, and we have made a small donation on your behalf to the 350.org organization.
Excellent.
That will further climate action and activities of people. They have a lot of, and we're going to talk a little bit about that in a minute, about that organization and how important it is around the world. So we just want to say thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for coming.
Thanks, everyone.